In the making of the IT industry, we have spoken to many industry builders. And now let's meet an icon, Nandan Nilekani. Nandan, of course, was one of the co-founders of Infosys and went on to create history of a kind in India by creating Aadhaar. Beyond that, today he is back as the very successful chairman of Infosys and an industry builder in the social sector, in startups, in so many other areas. It's amazing to meet a man like Nandan Nilekani. So here we are with Nandan Nilekani. As most of you know, Nandan has been a hero for the industry and for me personally, and many of us who built companies in the 90s and 2000s, because obviously what he did was unsurpassed by many, many at this point of time. Not only that, and particularly for me, who I'm now building on Digital India and doing a lot of work in the social sector, I think Nandan has some amazing stories in that area also. So very rarely will we get a combination of social, digital, as well as, of course, very strong corporate success. So Nandan, welcome. We're really delighted to have you.
And thank you,
Ganesh. Could we just start with a little, who is Nandan Nilekani? What made you who you are today?
Well, you know, I'm just like the boy next door. There was nothing special about me. I was born in Bangalore. Then at the age of 12, I went to a town called Dharwad, where I finished my schooling and PUC. And then from there, I wrote for the exams for the IIT. And I was very fortunate to get into IIT Bombay in 1973. And I had a wonderful experience studying electrical engineering at IIT Bombay. And then when I came out of IIT, I was looking for a job. And I met Mr. Narayan Murthy. At that time, he was the head of the software division at Putney. And he very kindly gave me a job offer to join Putney. And that's how I started working with him. And then in 81, he wanted to create a professional software company. And he was very kind enough to include me as one of the founders of that company. And that began my journey in software. And I worked at Infosys from 1981 to 2009. And I played all kinds of roles, including the role of the CEO. And that really gave me the experience of building a high quality, high performance, good corporate governance, a global software company.
Tell us a little more about, then after that, the government role, and then we'll come back to Infosys. And
yeah. So what happened was in 2008, I wrote a book called Imagining India, which did very well, and which talked about many things. But one of the ideas in that was the concept of a digital ID for Indians. And at the same time, the Indian government from 2006 had been planning an ID project. To give every Indian resident an ID, a unique ID. You know, they didn't necessarily call it digital, but they called it a unique ID. And I was offered the role of leading that in the rank of a cabinet minister very kindly by Dr. Manmohan Singh. So with the consent of my colleagues at Infosys, I stepped down and joined the government in July of 2009 and spent a very fruitful 4.5 years building the technology platform and rolling it out across the country. And by the time I stepped down in March of 2014, more than 600 million people had a digital ID. And then the program continued with even more vigor after I stepped down. And the new government came with Prime Minister Modi. And today it has 1.27 billion people on it. And it is a fundamental ID which drives financial inclusion, direct benefit transfer, KYC, it's used for making sure there are no duplicate ration cards, there are no duplicate PAN cards, there are no duplicate driving licenses. And now there's a proposal to make sure there are no duplicate voter ID cards. So its purpose has now been used across the board. It's very pervasive, and its ability to make unique everyone and make sure there are no duplicates and frauds has become a fundamental requirement of all the systems we have.
No, that's amazing, Nandan. And let me dive a little deeper into both. And coming to Infosys, I mean, most of us, in fact, we were talking to Mr. Murthy also. And I think we all agree that this is very much a middle-class industry created by middle-class, you know, people who are not to the manner born, if you will. And how do you think we got that confidence? I mean, here we are, all of us probably did our engineering in the 70s and started jobs. But how did one company like Infosys, or how did an entire industry, or for that matter, NASSCOM and everybody else, how did we suddenly find that we had the confidence to build a world-class industry? I mean, specifically Infosys, what did you guys do that was so special?
Well, I think Narayan Murthy assembled a fantastic team when he selected the co-founders of Infosys, and he made sure that there were people with different strengths, complementary to each other, who worked well and collaborated. And also, you know, we had a long-term vision. It was not about what we do next quarter or next year, but how do we build a company which is the most respected in the world? How do we build a company where the wealth is shared? How do we create a company where professionals are highly regarded? How do we create a company where we attract great talent and invest in continuous learning? How do we invest? How do we build a company which becomes very, very well known in the world? So, you know, all those long-term goals were their principles. Thanks to Narayan Murthy, and we all worked together as a one team, and it was slow going in the beginning. I mean, by 1992-93, we were still a very small company, but then we decided we had to go big in the wake of liberalization, and that's when the takeoff happened. We went public on the Indian capital markets in 93. We got a listing on NASDAQ in 99. We reached $1 billion in revenue in 2004, and so on. So fundamentally, I think it was a great team, great leadership under Narayan Murthy, and a commitment, long-term commitment to build a great company. And I must say that the IT industry, we all know, have done extremely well. We're talking about $190 billion in revenue across IT and BPO and so on, and generating millions of jobs, both directly and indirectly. And part of it is because I think we have all been very collegial in this industry. I think NASSCOM is a great example of an association of competitors, but all who came together on common issues and were able to work among themselves and with the government. And so unlike other industries where there's so much competition that they may not be talking to each other, I think in this industry, we all talk to each other, we all work together. And that's been one of the big reasons why I think this industry has done so well. And also we were among the first two Indians to think global. I mean, you know, our industry always had to think global because the domestic market for our services was very small. So from day one, Infosys began in 81. Many of the TCS began even earlier. So all the companies began with global. And therefore, in some sense, the globalization of India was led by the IT industry.
But in that logic, Nandan, I mean, a lot of people I know in Infosys give you a lot of credit, saying that Nandan's confidence to go and sell any dream to any global Fortune 500 CEO was unparalleled. So what gave you that confidence? That look,
well, I was fortunate that I was part of a great company. You know, it's too much. It's often we tend to give individuals credit, but really I was part of a phenomenal company. But, you know, I always believed in India. I've always believed in Infosys. I've always believed that Indians have an innate capacity for software and transformation through software. And also, you know, I had spent a lot of time in the early years of Infosys. I lived in the US from 1981 to 88 or thereabouts. And I was actually involved with meeting clients. So it gave me confidence to meet clients. You know, I've been to large global 5,000 companies, met boards. So somehow, maybe it was my training at IIT where you learn to, you know, sort of show confidence even when you don't know much.
You know, I agree with you. I did my PhD in IIT Bombay, so I can agree. It just does give you that level of confidence that you can be competitive with the world's best. That's so true.
That's right.
But tell me, people like us who look back in history, I mean, we all know Mr. F.C. Kohli. We know that he kind of discovered the power of the Indian programmer, if you will, whether they were IITians with M.Techs or whatever. But I think Infosys really legitimized and created the offshore story. You know, the campuses that we talked about. So whose idea was that? That saying that, look, it is not just Indians in America, but Indians in India doing great work globally. So because that's almost like a mind shift change from what people expected when they came to India. So how did you guys think of that?
Well, certainly, I think Mr. Kohli was in some sense the leader. And I still remember that at IIT Bombay, when Kanwal Rekhi and I donated money for the School of Information Technology, Kanwal and Dr. Fatak and I took a unanimous decision to name the auditorium after Mr. Kohli for his contribution to the industry. But I think a lot of the credit goes to Murthy, who saw that offshore development could work. And he believed that when customers came to India, and if they visited a company with a great campus, that would give them the sense that this company was here for the long term and was willing to invest in the future. And that's exactly what happened. Our first campus was built in 1992, probably the first software campus in India. And it became a huge part of what helped Infosys to grow, because it gave the world confidence that we were here to stay.
But including, even if you look at your Mysore training campus, for instance, yes. I mean, that's really world-class. So everything you did was world-class, high scale, etc.
That's right. Again, we all had a belief, again, inspired by Murthy, that we have to invest in learning and education. We set up our education and research department in the early 90s. We set up the Mysore campus around 2000. It's a beautiful campus, can train 40,000 people at one time. And so that, I think all these were really long-term bets. And today, so if you can think of my career, you can think of it in three parts. The first, obviously, was the first Infosys journey, 81 to 09, when I played different roles. And then I had a break for 8 years. Those 8 years included 4.5 years of working in the government to build Aadhaar. But even after that, I've been active in many other digital transformation programs for the country, including as an advisor to NPCI. I helped to visualize and drive the UPI payment system. Then I've been involved as someone designing the account aggregator system and many other, maybe 10 different things which are there in the sort of digital India space. So that's, in some sense, the second phase of my career. And then due to a set of circumstances, I had to go back to Infosys in 2017. And it's now about 3.5 years since I went back. And that, in some sense, is a third phase where, it's like going back to my roots kind of thing. And so each of those phases had enormous learnings and experiences for me.
Let's move to the second phase, Nandan, which is, you talked Digital India. And if I just put a kind of a alphabet soup of words that everybody talks about. We talk about the India stack. We talk about UPI. We talk about payment gateways. We talk about Aadhaar, the Jan Trinity. So can you, for the lay audience, can you just demystify? Why is this the most powerful story of digital India?
Sure, Gane. I think India is the first country to think of how to create a democratized approach to IT for everybody. In other words, when you have a population of 1.3 billion people, how do you build a technology that everyone has access to, everyone can use for their future? And that was the fundamental inspiration. And we knew that such a technology had to be very high volume, because you have to service the needs of a billion people. It had to be very low cost. It had to be very accessible. It had to be portable across the country, so that a person who was born in Bihar, if he's working in Kerala, can still use it. So the set of design principles brought about by the scale of India. And Aadhaar was the first bit of that, because that was the idea, was to give every Indian resident a digital ID, which he could use anywhere. And this was the idea of the ID on the cloud, was a whole new idea 10 years back, where I have an ID, which is not necessarily just a card in my pocket, but an ID on the cloud. So wherever I go in India, I can use it. And that played to India's emerging trends of mobility and migration as people moved around. And then the second thing, and that also led to the link of the ID system to banking system, because we realized that delivering, there are two important things that are required to move money. One was money from government to beneficiaries, what is called as direct benefit transfer. So you want to give a pension or a scholarship to somebody, how do you easily move it in a matter of 1 hour or 2 hours in electronically into somebody's bank account? That is one part of DBT. And the second part of DBT is the migration aspect. So as more Indians moved from north to south, from east to west, from rural India to urban India, there's a massive flow of money from people working in, say, Mumbai, somebody working as a driver in Mumbai, sending to his family in Orissa or something. And those are the remittances business. And both remittances, which are private flows, as well as government transfers, which are public flows, both required a payment rail to operate on. And that was the second big thing we built, which was the direct benefit transfer. India is the world's largest direct benefit transfer program. And it is now, it was at the heart of the success during the pandemic, because thanks to these payment rails, the government was able to send crores of rupees in small amounts to more than 100 million Indians to help them during the pandemic. And other countries took weeks and months. They had to mail checks and all that. We were able to do it electronically. So there's an example of how, if you create the right systems, we can, you know, transform the lives of people. The third, you know, then the UPI payment system again was a payment system that NPCI designed. We rolled it out in May 2016. And by October 2016, it just had 100,000 transactions. And then demonetization happened in November 2016. And that brought out the need for digital payments. The government embraced digital payments, embraced UPI, launched an app called Bheem. And today, UPI payments are about 2.3 billion a month. And that is again at the heart. I mean, to me, the other day I was, I'd gone for a haircut and I came out and there was a, you know, coconut vendor sitting there. And he had a sign saying, "I accept Google Pay." I said, "Boy, we've done it." If a guy selling coconuts in front of a, you know, on the street can use Google Pay and other UPI payments, then, you know, we have taken this to the people, right? So to me, it's all about how do we take so payments at that. But the biggest thing now, Ganesh, is what we call as account aggregator, because this is a framework which allows people to use their own data. This is very, very important, because what has happened so far is we all generate huge amounts of data, but that's not used by us. It's used by some company and then they peddle some ad to us or, you know, whatever. So it's used by somebody else. But in the Indian model, we have democratized data where every individual and every business can use their own data to move forward in life. And that is just getting rolled out. So I think these are all things to transform the country. Another thing I worked on was the RFID tags for roads. I wrote the original report 10 years back, and today you have the whole FASTag system where you just drive anywhere and you automatically pay your toll. So all the things are really not just abstractions, but how do we make a difference in the lives of the common person?
I agree. And in fact, I was part of a team that worked with Ministry and, of course, McKinsey Global Institute, then create this whole the $1 trillion digital India idea. And even there, we were talking about, I mean, like the India Stack and UPI, you could do similar things for agriculture, for SMEs, for employment. So do you think that is one way we can move? I mean, given all this data availability, given all the technology, we can literally take the whole country and make it work on technology.
Oh, absolutely, Ganesh. I think India is in a unique position because we are the only young country in an aging world. We are the only young country when China is rapidly aging because of their one-child policy. And when you're a young country in an aging world, you can be the source of services and products for the world. But as long as you have built the capabilities, you have the companies, you have the infrastructure, you have the education and skills, and so on. And that requires technology. I mean, you know, one of the things I've done in the last 4 or 5 years as the co-founder of Ixtep, which is a learning NGO, is built open source a technology called Sunbird, which can be used by millions of people for learning. It can be online, offline, using QR codes. And that has provided the underpinnings of Diksha, which is the government's education platform, which is reaching millions of teachers and children. So I think in every part of our life, in education, in healthcare, in financial services, our challenge is how do we take our services to 1 billion people? How do we make it accessible to them in every nook and corner of the country? How do we make it cheap and affordable? How do we enable small transactions because people can't afford to buy large transactions? And therefore, finally, I think of digital technology as a method of addressing inclusion, accessibility, and reducing inequality. And that's the prism with which I have looked at the use of technology in India.
Well, that's amazing, Nandan. And kind of brings me to the topic that I'm currently working on, which is we just finished a full policy paper on the asymmetry, economic asymmetry between India and China. In fact, I think a copy is probably already.
One at BIC.
That's right.
Yes. Dr. Kelkar sent it to me. Yeah.
I know. He told us he had sent it to you. So I hope you enjoy reading at least the executive. It's a very large paper. But when we were researching it, Nandan, and we actually found that obviously diplomacy is going to be important, collaborations is going to be important, economic revival is important. But obviously, where we have almost been left behind is the domestic industry. And if you look at, you know, from rare earths to electronics to auto components, I think we have a lot of catching up to do. I mean, to catch up with the $15 trillion economy where we are just under $3 trillion. The question to you is, do you think digital is a solution for that? I mean, you talked about it briefly. And of course, we have the big demographic advantage that you also alluded to. So what is your view on this? I mean, can India, I mean, we believe that if we now grow 8% per year for the next 25 years, and China by some miracle only grows for 4% because of demographic disadvantage, we could actually be maybe half the size of China in maybe 2045. But do you really believe digital is going to play a big role in making such things happen? If it happens?
No, I think digital is a huge role. Is it the only role? Of course not. We have other things we have to do. But digital is what enables all the things I've talked about. Access, affordability, small transaction size, high volume, and so on. So it's required to democratize. But it's also about the structure of businesses that we want to create. I think we must realize that India is not going to just be a few companies that are very, very large and hire millions of people. It's going to be millions of companies hiring a few people each. The strength of India is the MSMEs and the small companies we have. If we can enable them to grow, if we can enable them to get access to credit, if we give them access to markets, if we give them access to technology, if there are 10 million companies and they hire five people each, that's 50 million new jobs they'll create. Because finally, if you have to do this, it has to be by broad-based job creation across the board in all over India. That's also going to drive much more equality because everybody will have incomes. And that'll drive your 8% growth, but you need to get that right. Now, the challenge we have, for example, in semiconductors. Semiconductors is very capital intensive. And even in the West, the bulk of the semiconductor, except for Intel, which is a huge player in the US, most of the other US semiconductor companies are actually called are fabless. They don't have fabrication. They don't have the factories. And the factories are all in the East. They are in companies like TSMC in Korea, in Taiwan, or they are with Samsung in Korea. And you know, those guys are spending billions of dollars every year, 2 years, upgrading their 14 nanometer, 10 nanometer, 5 nanometer and all that. So I don't know whether India can play that game because they're already that's consolidating into two or three global players. Even the Chinese have not really been able to crack it. So I think where our game is that increasing commoditization of the manufacturing is actually driving the value to the software layer. Today, a company like NVIDIA is worth more than Intel. They don't make chips, but they design AI chips and GPUs, which is what makes them so valuable. So India can build a huge software layer of semiconductors, leverage the factories of the East and Korea and Taiwan, perhaps get one of them to invest in India. That's how I mean, maybe I'm not an expert, but that's how I think about it. And the other thing which is happening is that the semiconductor stack itself is becoming commoditized through open source. For example, there's a new software chip design called RISC-V. Which allows you to do open source chip design. So we need to think about those kind of, we need to play to our software strengths, even in hardware, because once hardware layer becomes commoditized, then we can create value on top of that hardware.
No, but that's an amazing point. And I think, I mean, after writing 60,000 words, I think you've missed this point. So we should probably include it somewhere. I completely agree with you. Because we looked at, you know, chemical clusters, agriculture, and even of course, the traditional industries of, all kinds of, you know, textiles, for instance, where we probably lost the boat, missed the bus even to Bangladesh. So I'm saying the opportunities are still there. But again, link leads to the other point I want to ask you. So do you think now there's an opportunity, in fact, there's an imperative for redistributing jobs? Because even today, there's a lot of job concentration in urban locations, which creates all the pressures. So do you think with the digital happening, the national optic fiber network really happening, hopefully, you will see 600,000 villages joining the party, or at least 600 metro towns rather than just the 10, 11 cities?
Well, I'm not sure about 600,000 villages, but certainly we can, there are two types of distribution. One is the urban-rural thing. And rather than have all the action in Mumbai, Bangalore, Delhi, and all that, we need to have, as you said, maybe 1,000 smaller towns that grow and become sort of nodes inside a region. The second is the spatial distribution. I mean, India is very well developed in the west and the south, but underdeveloped in the east and the north. So I think there's a spatial dimension as well as an urban-rural dimension. But absolutely, I think for having a stable society, for having an equal society, we have to distribute that. And it requires two things. It requires a digital layer which can distribute work, and that's where the fiber and all comes. It also requires a physical layer, getting the supply chain right, so that's a produce from some interior part of Bihar is able to reach a market somewhere through a very good supply chain. And both have to be put in place.
That's interesting. But I mean, do you think that's going to be the big challenge, the physical infrastructure? Because as we all know, China built physical infrastructure before development happened. Here we develop and then we try and build physical.
Yeah. Well, you know, they built and then the things happened. Now, India doesn't work like that. So in India, what happens is that you launch many airlines and then the airlines have no place to land. And then all the people in the planes get fed up and then the airports get built. So it's a different model of infrastructure, but that's okay. I think now we're at a point where there is going to be a huge, we are seeing it. I mean, today, for example, I mean, a decade back, we didn't really have the expertise to build metros. Today, for example, thanks to the work done on metros, like Bangalore, Pune, everyone is now building metros. So the technology of metro building has been sort of democratized. The technology of building highways has got democratized. Technology of building, so now we know these things. The learning curve has gone through it. So I think, yes, we can do a much better job now.
Okay, now that's very interesting. Just a question back on the industry, Nandan. In fact, we spent a fair amount of time in this series with starting with Mr. Murthy and then Harish Mehta. Then we moved on to Mohan Reddy for the whole engineering and other piece. And then we talked to Pramod Basin about BPOs. We have all these segments of the industry, but one segment, which I'm sure you and I will both agree at $10 billion or thereabouts, is the product industry. So where do you think in this lovely story of IT services, we talked about electronics and hardware, but that's a different story. But where do you think we missed the bus and what can we do to really be the product economy that all of us aspire to?
No, I think it's a great question, Ganesh. I think the very notion of products has changed. You know, 5 years back, we thought of products as licensed in-premise software. Today, when we think of products, we actually mean software as a service on the cloud. So that's really where it is. And the good news is that both there are startups that are doing good work in the SaaS world, and the bigger companies are trying to ensure that at least part of their offerings are offered as SaaS services. So the logical place to go for IT services companies is to SaaSify the offerings to the extent they can. And I think that is actually, because see, what is happening is because of the cloud coming, there's a great reset happening in the enterprise world. Everything is up for grabs because the enterprise is resetting everything to the cloud. So this is a great time for Indian companies to take advantage of this reset and become leaders in this new era.
You think the B2B SaaS itself can be a $50, $60 billion economy as we go along?
I think so, because we are going to create a post-cloud infrastructure where what the cloud does, apart from the fact that it converts CapEx into OpEx and all that, the cloud also allows you to mix and match SaaS offerings to create end-to-end business value. So you know, if you have a SaaS offering which you can plug into something else, then all that together creates business. But this was not possible in the earlier in-premise world. So yes, I think we can build a big business in this.
So tell us your current 2021 version of Imagining India. What would you look at India by 2020, by 2030, maybe 10 years from now?
Well, I think the order of the day for us, I think, is to get out of the pandemic, which means both good treatment and all that, but equally importantly, vaccinating at scale. I've been recommending for last 9 months now that we should build a vaccination system at 10 million a day. I think we're now at 2-3 million a day, and luckily, my good friend Ram Sevak Sharma is now in charge of the technology. So I'm sure he will enable it to go to 10 million a day. And so getting out of the thing is very important. I think the combination of the recovery from that and the the financial sort of stimulus and all happening will lead to great growth, at least in the coming year for the country. And I think then what will happen is what do we do next? And that's where I think putting in all the infrastructure, both digital and physical, so that we create a model where millions of companies can grow is the key. And to help that, we have to make sure that our people have access to the healthcare, livelihoods, and education and skills to be able to participate in this new economic growth. And again, let me not overstress this, but being a young country in an aging world gives you a unique strategic opportunity of really doing everything that the world needs.
So you really think India can be the alternative supply chain that we all think about?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think the world has realized that too much over-concentration in one country is not a great idea. So there is going to be the unbundling of supply chains. And I think the government also has all these production-linked incentives and so on. So there's a lot of action. Plus, India itself will be a huge market. So, you know, it makes sense to manufacture smartphones in India because you're going to consume millions of them and things like that.
So finally, Nandan, if you were now talking to a young Nandan Nilekani in Dharwad with dreams of going to IIT Bombay, what would your advice to him be? What should he be looking for doing in the new world economy?
Well, I think, you know, I would say always remain curious, always remain open-minded, always be willing to learn new things and reject or change old ideas that are no longer valid. And get up every morning trying to see how you can add value.
That's fantastic, Nandan. So on that note, thank you so much. Thank you for giving us your time. And I think it was absolutely pearls of wisdom, as always. And thank you for being with us.
Thanks, Ganesh. It was great talking to you after a long while. Thank you. Absolutely.